And again, these aren't, one day. This is stuff that exists now, and it's just looking to get up to scale and down in price. So here they are, the eight major technologies. First one is computer deep learning and big data. Computer deep learning, speed, and big data. Number two is artificial intelligence. Number three was Internet of Things. Number four was robotics. Number five was augmented reality. Number six was virtual reality. Number seven was synthetic medicine. And number eight was, I always have a hard time with this, genomic decoding and recoding. So let me just go through a few of these to give you an idea. And again, as I say these things, I want you to really keep in mind, this is stuff that's happening today and coming very, very fast. Actually, before I even say that, let me give you a little quote. I read a lot, I think Kendall mentioned, about 100, 120 business books a year. I also listen to a lot of audiobooks. And about a year, year and a half ago, I was driving in my car, listening to an audiobook, and a phrase came on that was so powerful, I actually had to pull my car over to think about it for a little while. And here's what the phrase was. And to be successful in the future, the rate of internal innovation must exceed the rate of external innovation. Spent this morning a little while, where's Lincoln in the back someplace, with the team from Cookie Time, and who's doing exceedingly well but want to push themselves to be even better. And the point that I made to them is, for you to be successful in an organization, you have to out-innovate, out-create, out-strategize, and out-execute everyone you compete with. But here's the challenge to all of you in the room, especially the students. For you to be successful in your career, you have to out-innovate, out-create, out-strategize, and out-execute everyone you compete with, quote-unquote, around the world. So a lot of what I'm going to be talking about is about how do I take that internal innovation, make sure it exceeds the rate of external innovation, and a big part of that is understanding what's coming. So let's look at computer speed and deep learning and big data. How many of you are familiar with Moore's Law? Okay, about half the room. For those of you that aren't, it was coined by Gordon Moore, one of the founders of Intel, their lead engineer. And about 30 years ago, he basically discovered or saw the pattern that chip speeds basically double every 18 months and half in price. In other words, computers get twice as fast and half as expensive about every year and a half. That was 30 years ago, and it's held for the last 30 years. So the example I like to use this, when Kendall and I were at KPMG earlier this week, good financial people, I asked them this question. Would you rather have $1 million cash today or a penny doubled every day for 30 days? Obviously, because I'm using an example, what's the answer? The penny. So here's what happens. For the first couple of weeks, the penny doesn't look so hot. 1 cent, 2 cents, 4 cents, 8 cents, 16 cents, all the way out to about day 27. And then it starts, as we say in the United States, hockey stick. It starts getting, by day 30, it's $5 million. That's where we are with computers, almost straight vertical. Now, here's the interesting thing. Very few people ask, what happens if you go another 30 days with the penny? Anyone want to take a guess? 5 quadrillion. Okay, that's the next 30 years with computers. To give you an example, how many of you have heard of Watson, the big IBM computer? Okay, only a few of you. It was a computer designed in America to be able to, what we would call, find known knowns. And we have a game show in America called Jeopardy. And what they do is they give you the answer, you have to ask the question. But everything is based on a fact. And they took Watson and it played the two greatest players in the history of that game and crushed them. I love it what one guy put on his final question. I, for one, welcome the coming of our computer overlords. But Watson does 3 trillion operations per second. 3 trillion operations per second. If there's an answer out there on the internet, it can find it instantaneously. Now, what they're using Watson for is to find unknown unknowns. Recently, they had a team of doctors come in, cancer researchers, who had spent nearly 20 years researching a certain cancer, and they had gotten it down to 6 proteins that they felt were probably one of these was the cause of the cancer. So they loaded everything they knew about the cancer into Watson, 22 million pages, and in 36 hours it gave them the answer. They said it would have been another decade and a half for them to figure it out on their own. Now, a couple of ideas about Watson. Now, I'll give you one other idea. In researching this talk to be prepared to chat with you all, I looked up and asked, what is the fastest computer in the world right now? Watson is 3 trillion operations per second. That's pretty darn fast. The fastest computer in the world is in China right now, and it's 33.86 quadrillion operations per second. Remember, that doubles in speed and halves in price about every year and a half. The only thing that contained Watson from going faster was the fact that it could only work off a certain number of servers. They just loaded Watson to the cloud, which means it has unlimited access to servers worldwide that are available to it. And a lot of people have said, and you know, I'm not a futurist, by the way. That's not part of my job at all. My job is to understand all this so I can help my clients. I study all this stuff because this is going to impact all the people I work with. So you look at that and say, this is amazing. Many scientists had said, and people said, it's probably we're going to hit the limit in about 15 years as far as chip speed for Moore's Law. Moore's Law will die in about 15 years. The newest research I've seen, they believe with quantum computing, they can increase it by 11 million times. Take 33.86 quadrillion operations per second times 11 million. That's coming in the next 15 years. David sort of hit it real quick, but I'll give you the quick example I like to use with the iPhone. And part of the reason is I wanted to make sure I didn't forget it, so I'm coming to go over and use this example. As he mentioned, and I'll mention it in a little bit more detail, if you had wanted to buy something that does everything this phone does in 1964, the year I was born, you couldn't. This is more technology than existed on the face of the earth in 1964. Talk about every major superpower in the world, China, you know, you, everybody. This is more technology than all their leaders had access to. Fast forward to 1982, the year I graduated from college, you could buy something that could do all this would do. It cost $3.2 billion and was the size of two tractor trailer trucks. Fast forward to today, I can buy this for about $600-700, put it in my pocket. It's basically a supercomputer in your pocket. Would you agree? I mean, this is unheard of just 50 years ago. Unbelievable. Now you put it in your pocket. 10 years from today, 2026, you will be able to buy something that does everything this thing does for $5, and it will be the size of a human blood cell. Which gets me to Internet of Things. Internet of Things is extremely small computers, tiny down to the microscopic level. They've now got computers that are basically the size of a human blood cell that they can inject into your body, will find a cancer cell, latch onto it, and distribute just the right amount of medicine or chemicals to try to kill that cancer cell. Injecting computers into your bloodstream. One of the companies I work with in America is called Monsanto, one of the largest producers of seeds and fertilizer in the world. I recently had a chance to meet with their CEO. We were given a talk together, and he mentioned to the group of farmers we were with, soybean farmers in America, that Monsanto was no longer in the seed or fertilizer business, that they were now a big data company. And the way they do it is they spread tiny nanocomputers across the entire field, and with a drone, they measure the fertilizer level, the moisture level, how many bugs there are, how much aeration there is in the soil, and then the tractors that they run can go out and actually spray pesticide on one bush, fertilizer on the next one, a little bit more water on the next one, and give individual care to individual plants on the property. And what he said is, if we can get our farmers to use our data with our tiny computers in the soil for 5 years, we'll have enough data and be able to help them enough that they will never ever do business with another company because we own their data. They'll have to buy our seeds and fertilizer because without that, they don't get the data. So think about this. A farming company that makes seeds and fertilizer now sees themselves as a big data company optimizing yields on farms around the world. Internet. Now let's use that a little bit further at the other side, robotics. If you look at computer algorithms from deep learning and big data and robotics, there are many people that say probably 20 to 40% of jobs are gonna go away in the next 15 years. Give you an example. In America, we're fighting real hard around minimum wage. The minimum wage for us is about $7.90 an hour. They want to bump it to $15 an hour. Now, what happened then is what's called the law of unintended consequences. There is a robot they've invented now that can make hamburgers just as well or better than anyone that works at McDonald's. And the fees, or the expense for the entire team of people that make McDonald's hamburgers a year per shop, all of them combined, is about $110,000. The robot costs $111,000. It will work for probably 8 to 10 years without any failure, never shows up late, never has a cold, never complains, never argues, and that means that you can replace your entire staff with a 1 year payback and everything else is profit, and you don't have to deal with any people. I'm sure some of you here are seeing that in a lot of your restaurants are becoming fully automated. When my wife and Sheila and I travel, you go to most restaurants, you've got an iPad, you type in what you want, you hit the button, you swipe it, one person shows up, hands it to you, and they walk away. They can do the entire floor with one or two servers and no one to take orders. The orders are all done right because you put them in the computer. A good friend of mine designs cruise ships. And the cruise ships he's designing today have no bartenders. They're all run by computer. You go in, you type in the iPad what you want, a computer robot, all the bottles are on the ceiling, the robot goes, slides it down, you have your drink. That means no spillage, no overpouring, no tipping, and no one stealing out of the till. And those robots cost about $60,000, which is, it's about $90,000 per bartender, $60,000 replaces all the bartenders. Here's the interesting thing, you take that move out, you've got legal assistants, pretty much gone, legal researchers, gone. Computer can do it in just a few minutes. A lot of the writing in America now is done by computers. If you read a sports story, most of them are written by computers. Financial reports, written by computers. A lot of stuff done by algorithms. We just did some work with a big financial firm, and the president of the firm stood up to their top financial advisors and said, unless you change the way you do business, you will not be in business in 5 years. And I'll make a caveat here to give you a little happy spot. I see my wife looking at me like, please don't kill them. please don't destroy their hope. The interesting thing here is that the only thing computers can't do is create relationships. They can't have empathy. They can't make human connection. So as long as there is some human connection, some empathy, there will always be leaders, there will always be leadership, there will always be things like that. But we are facing in society a very significant disruption that's going to disrupt the way we do business, the way your clients do business, the way we do education, and the way society works, when an awful lot of those jobs go away, and you're either going to have very high-paying computer-based jobs, high-level leadership jobs, things like that, or lower-level jobs that have the human components to it, some service jobs, healthcare jobs, things like that. Let me see. So we did that. Robotics. I think that's about as far as I want to go on the technology. Let's now talk about the second part. They said the two things I should share with you is the incredible pace of technology and that it is not going to slow down. It's going to increase exponentially and get faster and faster. The other side of that is they said EQ, that the leader of the future is someone that has not only a high IQ, they're smart, they're bright, they're talented, but they have a high EQ, their emotional quotient. Another word you could use here is empathy. They have the ability to connect with other people. I took a test not too long ago on empathy. Take your phone, take mine, just keep them both. Took a test not too long ago on EQ. It was exceedingly low, close to zero. Yeah, and I took another test on self-competitiveness, and I broke the scale. And I'm like, I go to the guy, I go, I broke the scale, I'm number one. He goes, you don't want to be number one on this test. It's for self-competitiveness. So I go, but I'm the best, right? And he goes, that's not, and I go, no, just tell me, I'm number one in the world, right? He goes, yes. I go, great. He goes, you're not well. So, but the idea here is that to be a leader in the future, you're going to have to be a great collaborator. You're going to have to be a great team builder. You're going to have to be amazing at building relationships. I've been teaching leadership now for about 22 years. And when I first started doing it, it was command and control. Do as I say, not as I do. I'm 52. When I showed up for my first job, my boss said, jump. I said, how high, sir? It was a man, and you just did what they told you to do. If they told you to work Friday night, Saturday, Sunday, Monday night, you just put your head down and you did the work. And I see some of the folks more in my generation going, not so much anymore. Then the pendulum swung way over to management by numbers, leadership by spreadsheet. People weren't people, they were a number. We're going to minimize costs, which means fire everyone. We're going to decrease efficiencies. Let's offshore everything. And everything was run basically by spreadsheet MBAs and numbers. The pendulum now has swung back to what we would call servant leadership, leadership that's about connection and collaboration. So in when I saw those shifts happening, one of the things I did is reach out to a lot of the folks that I've worked with in the last several years. I was very fortunate to run the Global Leadership Development Program for Merrill Lynch for about 7 years. Did some work with some teams at Microsoft, coached some people from Apple, a whole bunch, I won't go into it. But in these companies, I had access to their very, very best employees. Sheila, raise your hand, my wife. She's laughing at me. She's videotaping me. Not video. Now, that shows how old I am, right? She's recording me. We have a friend in Seattle that was one of the global directors of marketing for Microsoft. She decided she didn't like the job, a little bit too much politics. She announced at 9 o'clock in the morning that she didn't want to work in there. Headhunters were on here by noon. She had a job at Amazon.com as a senior vice president of marketing within a week. Right? So when you look at the employees I'm talking about here, they're people any of you would love to have on your team. Love, you'd die to have people like this. But the interesting thing is they're what I call voluntary employees. They don't go to work because they have to, they go to work because they want to. Because they're so talented, they have options. If anything is not the way they want it, they can pick up and go find a similar job at a similar company at a similar salary tomorrow. So I went to these folks and said, if you could work anywhere in the world that you want to work, why do you choose where you work? Why do you work where you work? And then I asked them a second question. Well, I'll tell you that one, by the way, real quick for the business owners in the room and the future business owners. Six key factors to attract top talent in the world from top talent telling me. Number one, pay. But the key word, fair pay. Not the most, not exorbitant, and the way they defined fair pay was 10% above or below what I would make to do the same job anyplace else. So basically, as long as you get parity on pay, I can't look around and make 30 or 40% more anyplace else. I'm going to make about the same, and if I do make 30 or 40, I should jump for myself and my family. But if it's roughly the same, then we look at the other five factors. Factor number one, challenging, meaningful work. I want to come to work every day and know I'm doing important work, I'm using my best skills, it's engaging, it's challenging, it's fun. So challenging, meaningful work. Number two, cool colleagues. I had the incredibly great honor today, Kendall set it up, to have lunch with Reuben Thorne. Did I say that correctly? Yeah, just met him today. Former captain of the All Blacks. And we were talking about the fact is, if you want a world championship team, you want world championship players. You don't go, hey, you're not so good at rugby, but we love you. Come on, play on the All Blacks. It doesn't work that way, right? You got to be the best of the best in the world. So that's what they said, too, is if I'm among the best, I want to play with other people that are among the best. I want to be around eight players. Number four is winning culture. And winning culture is defined in a lot of ways, but I can summarize it pretty quickly. And if you want to ask a question about this later, I can go into more detail. But the way that I summarize winning culture, people smile just as much when they come to work as when they leave, right? If they get out of the parking lot, they've got a big smile on their face, they're looking forward to getting to work, they like the people they work with, they enjoy their work, and at the end of the day, they're still smiling. Yes, they love their holiday, yes, they love their weekends, but they also love what they do for a living. So we've got fair pay, cool, meaningful challenging work, cool colleagues, winning culture. Those are the first four. Number five and number six are really, really powerful. They're sort of the fulcrum point here. Number five is personal and professional growth. And as you look at millennials and Gen Z and the folks that are starting to graduate now, this is imperative to them. If they're talented, they want to know that at the end of the month, I'm smarter than I was at the beginning of the month. And I just saw a bunch of them go like this. You know, it's funny. If you can see me, I can see you. So put that phone away. Just kidding. What they said is, if my company's not investing in me, if I'm not getting training, development, coaching, mentoring, the ability to go back to university and learn more things, to come here and go to a thought leadership class, if I'm not getting invested in for my own personal growth, I don't want to work there. Number two is professional growth, which says I need to look up 5 to 7 years from now in the company I'm working for and see a place for me. If a really talented person is working for you and they don't feel like they're getting any smarter or better, or you're investing in them, and they can't really see that there's a place for them in the business 5 to 7 years from now, what do? Leave immediately. They start looking immediately. And then number six, which is the reason that I'm here tonight and that all of you are here tonight, And they said that, and I didn't put these in orders, actually number six was the most important. They even said, and remember, best of the best in the world, if you give me okay on the other five, but number six is strong, I'll stay. Number six was, work for a leader I respect and admire. You give me pretty good pay, we got a good culture, all that other stuff. I work with pretty good people, but I really look up to my leader and respect and admire them, they will stay. The reverse, 88% of people that quit their jobs, don't quit the job, don't quit the hours, don't quit the pay, don't quit the workload, what do they quit? Their idiot boss, right? Can't stand this fool, I'm out of here. So when you look at what it takes to attract the best of the best in the world, it's fair pay, meaningful, challenging work, cool colleagues, winning culture, personal professional growth, leader I respect and admire. Those are the things. You give them lots of that, you'll get the best in the world. Now let's go to the second question I asked him. What are the characteristics of a leader you would willingly follow? Not famous leaders, not iconic leaders, not leaders, but who do you want to go for? Who would you respect and admire? So they came back with seven C's. The first C, character. Character. Another word for this would be integrity, and it's all underlined by honesty. Have any of you read the book Leadership Challenge by Kuzis and Posner? Got like three or four crazy freak people. For the rest of you, it's about 360, 400 pages. Great book, but it's a little tough to get through. If you want to read a great book on leadership, there's another one called The Truth About Leadership, also by Kuzis and Posner, that's only about 220 pages. If you go to my website, which is johnspence.com, I've got a list there of the top 60 business books I've ever read. So it's on that list. So Kuzis and Posner, I want to talk about this idea of character. They did a 30-year research study, four continents, 3 million respondents. 30 years, four continents, 3 million respondents. They asked the same question I asked. That's where I got it. I stole it from them. What are the characteristics of a leader you would willingly follow? 89% of the people worldwide, let's just call it 90%, had the exact same first answer, honest. The single most important thing that people look for in a leader they would willingly follow. I'm not going to talk about politics in America on that one, so that's off the table, but tell the truth all the time, honest. The next one was forward-looking. What's another word for forward-looking? Visionary. And I've got some very specific phraseology I use here. What they're looking for, someone who will give you a vivid, compelling, and well-communicated vision and strategy for growth. That comes from another huge research project by Harvard, from some of my colleagues, but it's a vivid, compelling, and well-communicated vision and strategy for growth, forward-looking. Number three was competent. But the key idea here is you don't have to be able to do everybody's job well. You have to be really good at whatever your job description is and your leadership skills. You got to be toweringly competent at what you're supposed to do and really, really good at your leadership skills. That's competence. The next one was inspiring. And this doesn't mean you've got to give big speeches and make everybody cry and, you know, get all excited and run around. It can be a very humble inspired. It can be quiet. And I think an inspired, excited leader with humility is as strong or stronger than a leader that jumps up and down sometimes. They both work, charismatic versus the other one. But here's the key. If you aren't inspired, no one else on your team will be. If you're not excited, if you're not passionate, if you're not dedicated, if you're not inspired, you're not inspiring. So number four was inspiring. Now, those first four, honest, forward-looking, competent, inspiring, were the same for about the first 25 years of the research study. 2.5 decades. In the last 5 years or so, thank you millennials and Gen Z in the room, two new ones joined the list. Ready for this? Fair and supportive. And I'd like a trophy for that, please. And maybe a ribbon for participation. Just teasing, not that much. But that is a major change. 2.5 decades, honest, forward-looking, competent, inspiring. Year after year after year, now add in fair and supportive. So let me take this entire book and boil it down to one sentence. 400 pages, 30 years of research, one sentence. Here it is. People around the world look for a leader who will tell me the truth, has a clear idea where we're going, has the skills to get us there successfully, is excited about going with me, and will treat me fairly and support me along the way. I'll say that one more time because that's pretty powerful. I want a leader who will tell me the truth, who has a clear vision of where we're going, who has the skills, the competence necessary to get us there successfully, is inspired, passionate, and excited about going with me, and will treat me fairly and support me along the way. If you do those six things, I believe you're building a great foundation for being an effective and successful leader. And that was number one on my list, was character matched up to them. Theirs was, mine was character, theirs was honesty. Number two from these 10,000 high potential employees was competence, exactly the same that we saw with Kuzis and Posner. Number three was courage. Now, it's interesting. They said, of course I expect my leader to be courageous, to take the big, bold risk, make the tough decisions, you know, do the things that are important to move the company forward. Of course I expect that. But what I really want is a leader that is courageous enough to be vulnerable, to admit I don't have all the answers. Technology moves too fast. Competition's too fast. Things are too agile. I know an awful lot, but I don't know everything. And by the way, if you try to pretend that you do know everything, everybody knows you're lying. Right? Because you can't know everything. You can't keep up. You need to ask for help. So what they said here is, I want a leader who's courageous enough to be vulnerable and authentic and ask for help. And that doesn't mean you sit in the corner, you know, sucking your thumb, I'm completely wiped out. No, 90% of the time you're strong, you're bold, you're making the tough decisions. 10% of the time you put your hand up and go, I need help. That's why I hired all of you. You're really, really good at what you do. You're great at this. I'm not great at this. I need your help to do it. So courage. The next one was communication. And what they told me was, of course I expect my leader to be a good communicator. I expect to be able to stand up and tell me that vivid, compelling vision and tell me about the rituals and the stories and get me inspired and excited. Of course I want that. But what I really want is a leader who is excellent asking questions and an intense listener. I want someone who's extremely curious, who hired bright people and is interested in what they're thinking. So they're asking good questions, they're asking just the right question at just the right time to get just the right information, and then they're actually listening to it and implementing it. What a great idea. So they, you know, and again, remember who I'm talking to. These are the best of the best, the people you'd love to have. Why in the world, if you had people like that on your team, would you not ask for help and follow their advice? So big idea. We only have one younger person in here, Katana, and she's I won't scare her away with too much profanity, but I won't go over the edge here, but I will give you a little phrase we use in our business. As a consultant, when someone asks me for advice over and over again, I give them advice and they don't implement it, we call them assholes. because they're constantly, I love it, you almost died there. So the idea there is, I'm going to get great people, then I'm going to ask them for help, communication. The next one was collaboration. Collaboration. Here's what these top people said. I understand you're the leader. I got it. You're the president. You're the director. You're the chairman of the board. You're the CEO, the owner. I got that. Just don't lord it over me. You know? If every now and then you got to say, do this because I own the company. Do this, I'm the board of directors. Whatever it might, I can handle that. But the rest of the time, 90% of the time, I want you to be a partner, a peer, and a team member. I want to see you roll up your sleeves, get in there, shoulder to shoulder with us, do the work with us, be part of the team. And if you do that consistently, and most of the time, when you do have to pull rank on me and tell me to do something, I have no problem with it. If it's the other way around, big problem with it. And again, talent that gets over micromanaged like that leaves pretty quickly. The next one is compassion. Compassion. And what they said, and again, this is driven a lot by the millennials and the new people entering the workforce, which say this: I'll come and do the work you asked me to do. I'll work my 40, 45, 50 hours a week, whatever you've hired me for, you're paying me. I'm happy to do that. But really don't ask me to work 5 minutes more than that. Because I want to go home and I love it again. You're like, yeah. And New Zealand's a little bit more of a lifestyle sort of a culture. But especially in America, where we see this everywhere, is folks now are saying, you have to have the compassion to understand that I have a life outside of here. You need to treat me well, respect me, show me that I'm important, but you also need to let me know that, or you need to treat me in a way that says, it's all right to go home at the end of the day and be with your family or go do your hobby or your sport or go out and drink with your friends, as long as you come back tomorrow and do excellent work. And again, in my generation, I've got a couple of friends up there. It wasn't 40 or 50 hours, it was 60, 70, 80, I can't remember how many hours it was, and if you didn't do that, you got terminated. You had to do the extra hours for no extra pay, or there was no job. Today, with talented people, they say, push me too hard, I don't want the job. I'm coaching a young man, mentoring a young man in America, whose family owns about $100 million business now. Over the next 2 years, it should be about $250 million, $250 million. A couple hundred employees, fast growth company. And I was talking to him not too long ago and said, you know, you're being groomed for CEO and I'm here to help you do that. And you're gonna have to really put in some effort. He goes, whoa, wait a minute. I'm not working more than 40 hours a week. I say, hang on a second. He goes, hey, I'll work 50 every now and then. If there's a major emergency, I'll put in 60 1 week a year. But the rest of the year, 40 hours a week, I'm going home to be with my kids. That's important to me. I said, I'm having a really hard time believing you could be the CEO of a $250 million company with 400 employees that's fast growth in 40 hours a week. And he looked at it, he goes, if I can't do it, then I don't want the job. Now, the other side of this, there are plenty of millennials and people that have that drive and want to do it and want to be leaders, but we're seeing a disconnect between, well, in the next decade, we're going to have the first time in the history of the world that I know of that we'll have six different generations at work. Science, come on in. She's bringing me vodka. Excellent. Excellent. Good. I appreciate it. Hopefully it's Smirnoff. Oh, it's tequila. We're going to see the first generation with six generations at work. I just saw a Time magazine cover earlier this year that said children born today, babies born this year, they're estimating will live to be 120 to 140 years old. They will be effective and in the workforce well into their 100s. Okay? What do you do with a workforce where people stay and work till they're 110, 120 years old? We've got the silent generation, baby boomers, Gen X, Gen Y, millennials, and Gen Z. All will be working in the same building. Slightly different values, slightly different culture, and it's going to be a struggle to lead all those people. So the idea of collaboration and compassion is going to be essential to be the sort of team builder and relationship builder necessary to cross all those different generations in one company. Unbelievable challenge to flex and get around things and be able to lead at that level. The seventh and final C is one that when I was going to write a book on this, and I started to write it, and I picked up another book that had almost exactly the same information. I mean, it was all C's. I think they had eight instead of seven. I said, somebody's been sitting in the back of my lectures, copied all my shit, now they're going to write a book, right? I mean, like, oh, yeah. But the truth of the matter is, all my stuff's based on research and real life. If I saw the patterns, probably anybody else looking would see the same patterns. And so I decided not to write the book, but when I was thinking about it and bouncing it off my agent and a couple other people, they said, oh, you got to leave number seven out. Nobody will believe it, especially in America. Don't even do it. Take that chapter out. Number seven, contribution. That after you become a true leader, you've got access to capital, you've got access to resources, you have influence in your company and your community, that you should take all of those things and invest them in the future. And the phrase that I love is, you must plant the seeds of trees under which you may never sit. And especially in America, that's not the way a lot of our leaders think. They're run by quarter to quarter by Wall Street. It used to be that. Then it was month to month. Then it was day to day. And it's pretty much hour by hour Wall Street's watching what they do. And stock prices go up and down all day long. Definitely from day to day, they can go in huge jumps. Ask the people at Yahoo and a couple other ones. And oh, Pokemon Go, who's that from? Nintendo? You see their stock went like this and went right back down the next day. Yeah, just wow, it's whoop, you know. And what we like to say is the cycle from hero to goat has gotten much faster. And that's what happened with them. And what I'm saying is that you've got to invest in things that are long term. One of my favorite pieces of research I did years ago was on Japanese companies. And it wasn't all of them, but there were a handful of Japanese companies that had been around for hundreds of years that when their chief executive officer retired, stepped down, they did not get their bonus until 15 years after they left the company, based on the stock price 15 years out, which means they had to sit at their desk today and make 20-year decisions. That's what that final idea about contribution is. And the idea here, and it's a new idea I'm working on, is to leave a legacy on purpose. And I believe there's three areas that you leave a legacy on purpose. First is yourself. What kind of a legacy do I want to leave with my family, my friends, the people I love? What is that legacy, my own personal legacy? Number two, as a leader of an organization, it's the legacy I leave of my organization. Is it going to be around 20 years from now? Am I making the right investments in people and resources and things like that, that I know that I'm building a foundation for a long-term successful company that will last far beyond when I leave the organization? And the last, and perhaps, no, not perhaps, the most important, in my opinion, is what is the legacy of leadership I'll leave? And how am I leading on purpose today to allow me to use my resources, my influence, my time, to shape other leaders and leave a legacy of leadership in my community, in my organization, hopefully in the world? So when I looked at what it takes to be an effective, successful leader based on feedback from some of the top employees in the world, here's what it is: character, competence, communication, courage, compassion, collaboration, and contribution. And that was in a different order than I just told you because I couldn't remember it. So those are that. The last thing I want to share with you, we've got about 10 minutes, is I know I've got a lot of entrepreneurs and business owners in the room, and I want to take one last minute to share with you what I call my formula for business excellence. This is based on a massive amount of research and working with hundreds of companies all over the world looking for the pattern of excellence. And to me, I've got an equation here that summarizes the four most important things I believe you need to have to build a long-term successful business. Whether you have two employees, 20, or 200,000, same deal. So it's T plus C plus ECF times DE. Let me explain it. The T stands for talent. You want to win in the future, you got to have the best people you can possibly get. The most educated, the brightest. Now, it doesn't mean everybody has to have five advanced degrees from, you know, Ivy League schools and, you know, University of Canterbury and everything else. It just means that for the position I'm going to hire, I want to get the best talent I can possibly get for that position. And somebody that I'm going to hire as a receptionist or someone to clean up the office has a slightly different skill set than my CFO, but I want both of them to be great. Kendall mentioned that I've been teaching at Wharton for a couple years on strategy and strategic thinking. And one of the things I can boil down is for most businesses today, not all, but the vast majority, most of the competitive differentiators you had in the past are gone. People can copy your product pretty quickly or reverse engineer it. They can undercut your price. They can throw more money at promotion and marketing. They can meet or beat your distribution. A lot of that stuff falls away. But you know what can't be copied? The quality of the people on your team and the relationships they create with your customers. So to me then, a major strategic imperative in most companies should be talent acquisition, talent development, and talent retention. How do we find, grow, and keep the best people? And then another idea is then how do we own the voice of the customer? And a phrase I teach a lot, it's one of my top mantras, is whoever owns the voice of the customer owns the marketplace. Absolutely hits to the heart of what you said about education and listening to all of you and getting feedback about how does this university continue to evolve, grow, improve, to deliver what you need. You are the customers, own the voice of the customer, own the marketplace. So that's talent. I want the best people, and I'm going to get to the relationships in a minute. Talent. The C stands for culture. Culture. And there's two sides of the culture coin. Side one is what do the employees want? And to put it in a phrase, they want a winning culture. But here's some of the elements, and I wouldn't try to write this down because I'm going to go too fast. By the way, am I speaking fast enough? I can talk faster. I used to coach a CEO in Vienna years ago, and he brought me in to talk to his whole staff about the size of this room, a little bit less. And he talked like Arnold Schwarzenegger. And he got up and goes, I've talked to John. I have asked him to speak slower. He cannot. You will all have to listen faster. So culture, side one is the winning culture, and here's what people look for. A fun place to work with a family atmosphere where I work with my friends, oftentimes my best friend. I'm treated fairly, and that's not pay. That's in if there's a problem, an issue, something goes wrong, that my voice will be heard. Yes, fair pay is over here, but they did not say pay. Pay was number 13. So I'm treated fairly. I have the training, the support, and the resources I need to do my job, that I'm given the freedom to go do my job, no micromanagement. I take pride in the organization. I'm very proud when I'm wearing my University of Canterbury cufflinks, which I just bought at the bookstore, or my wife bought for me in my t-shirt. But I'm proud to say this is who I'm affiliated with. This is the business I work for. Here's my business card. Here's a tough one for all of you in the room that are managers and leaders. Praise. Some sort of genuine, honest, sincere praise once every 7 to 10 days. So some of you are freaking out right now. Here's the answer to that. It doesn't have to be just from the leader. It could be from anyone in the organization. In most organizations, if you make a mistake, there is someone there to point it out rather quickly. And they are happy to do it, right? In most organizations, on the other side, if you do something good, not great, just good, nobody says anything. Do you agree? Okay, what we're talking about here with the praise is, this is an important phrase for me, create a culture of catching people doing things right. Yes, we're going to still hold them accountable. They have to deliver business results, but let's celebrate small, medium, and big wins. Let's look for ways to pat people on the back, write them a handwritten note, and say, you're doing a good job, thank you. So that's praise. The next one was, let's do this one first. Again, these are the ones that started. It was a fun place to work with a family atmosphere where I work with my friends, oftentimes my best friend. I'm treated fairly. I have the freedom to do my job well. I take pride in the organization and I get praised once every 7 to 10 days. Again, for 20 years, those were it. Year after year after year. In the last 4 to 5 years, 2 ones have joined the list. Meaning and accomplishment. Again, this is the generation that's moving into the workforce that says, I want to do something important. As they say at Apple, I want to make a dent in the universe. I want to have a job that I know I'm making an impact through my job or our company. And if my job is menial, not that meaningful, then I want to work for a company that does meaningful stuff, that they have an impact on the community or the world. Meaning, and then the last one is accomplishment. Or another word you could use there is results. I want to be able to point to something and say, I did that. That's my work. So when you look at a winning culture, it's those 9 factors that most employees look for in the kind of culture they want to work in. The other side of that coin is you also have to have a culture of disciplined execution, a culture that delivers business results, meets their numbers, delivers quota, delivers the level of customer service. Again, talking to hundreds of CEOs, owners, directors, they all summarize what they look for at this side in 2 words. I want someone who works for me that has an ownership mentality. There it is. Someone that treats the business as if it were their own. That looks at every dollar that comes in, says, how can we increase revenue, increase profitability, increase market share, decrease waste, decrease cost, decrease churn? How can we make, in other words, there, and the word I like to use here is they're intrapreneurs. They're entrepreneurial inside of the company. They treat their part of the company, their job, as me, Inc. And I'm going to run this part of the business the best I possibly can and be a great CEO of my part of the business and be entrepreneurial and innovative and creative and constantly trying to get better and have an ownership mentality. That's culture. The next one is extreme customer focus, ECF. And I'm very careful about the words I use, and extreme is exactly the word I want to use here. These are organizations that understand that the customer pays all of the bills. That the brand new freshman that walks into this university has a very large lifetime value, will spend a lot of money here, and pays the salaries of everybody that walks in the door every day to teach him. So they get extremely close to their customer. They own the voice of the customer. And I can tell you this, that about 90 to 95% of the organizations I work with are pathetic at this. They think they know their customer. They think they listen to him. But when you really go and look at it, they do not have the level of customer focus that is going to be necessary to win in the future. Because again, that's one of the only differentiators. It's the relationships you create with your customers. And then last but not least, you take those first 3 things, talent, culture, extreme customer focus, and you multiply it by disciplined execution, or another word, there would be accountability. Very high levels of both personal, mutual, and reciprocal accountability. In other words, I'm gonna do what I said I would do, I'm gonna keep my promise, I'm gonna hold you accountable for doing what you said you would do, and I'm going to expect, even encourage, you to hold me accountable for what I was supposed to do so we can create a high-performance organization, a high-performance team, where we all agree to help each other meet and exceed the needs of our customers and exceed the expectations we had for the success of our business. So when I look at that, that's roughly what I think are 4 fundamental things that aren't the only 4 things. Got to have good financial management, got to have good quality products and services, all those other things. But if you don't have those things, then it's pretty much impossible to run a sustainably successful company that will be around 10, 15, 20, 25 years from now. So that's about all I've got right now. I'd love to open up the floor for about 15, 20 minutes to answer the specific questions that you might have around business, change, leadership, a bunch of other stuff. I prefer to stay away from politics, but if you nail me, I'll answer the question. So first question from someone way in the back. Yes, sir.
test on a robotics
mission,
classic example too, but what's going to happen to people in the future? Are we going to be useless then? I mean, can't we going to be teaching people that are going to be not going to be able to work in the future? What's the point?
Well, let's just go get drunk and pass out then, shall we? Yeah, that's pretty much where I'm headed. Now, you know, you hit at the heart of one of the major questions we came up with. We had, you know, 300 global thought leaders there, CEOs, all this stuff, and we spent almost a full day on what does this mean to society? When algorithms and deep learning and big data replace a lot of jobs that exist today, and robotics replaces a lot of workers. For example, they're looking at, in China right now, they're starting to figure out that we can use robots to build stuff cheaper than we can use, quote unquote, I don't like the words, but peasants. That for the cost of paying them a little teeny bit of money, housing them, feeding them, giving them health care, turning on the lights all day while they work, or day and night, that we could put robots in there that need no food, no health care, no place to live, and we don't even have to turn on the lights. At the end of the day, it's actually cheaper to manufacture that way. So it's not just all, it's all the way down in this thing. And it was a very sobering discussion. And I could go on, do a little research, look at the jobs that they are anticipating will go away. It's scary from the realm of it. And again, we were talking about this with education. The tough thing with education is we're attempting today to educate people for jobs that don't exist on equipment that hasn't been invented. So to answer your question, here's what our discussion was around. Guaranteed universal payment for being alive. If you wake up in the morning and you're still alive in the afternoon, you get $40,000 a year. If you want to work and start a company and be innovative and get a job, you make more. If you want to volunteer, maybe you get some credit. But everybody gets paid. And you know, I'm not saying I believe this. You know, and I want to make a clear point here. Everything tonight is my opinion. You know, I'm this isn't all exactly right. I'm not the world's leading expert on this. I'm among the top 100. But but you know, this is opinion. And the opinion of the folks there were the technology will likely move so fast we will not be able to train many people in the middle to keep up with it. And it's going to outstrip their ability to learn. So education is still going to be extremely important, if not more important. But some people are going to get left behind because they can't keep up with the pace. And the answer there was universal payments for being alive and your family. Now, the other thing that came up that was a huge issue, two more, was what happens when computers in 2045, you buy a laptop that's got more intelligence than the entire human race in your laptop. And it figures out you are not very valuable to it. You're this little bug that lives there, that messes up things, eats stuff, poops everywhere. I don't really need you around anymore. So what happens when the computers get smart enough that they realize they don't really need us? Because we've already got robots that can build other robots, and we've got computers that can self-program themselves. One of the things I saw was fascinating, and I won't go into all the detail of it. There's a couple of hurdles about when computers start to become sentient, not with ethics, but at least smart, is when they can program themselves. They took one of these supercomputers and gave it like 100 different video games and gave it one command: learn how to win. And 40 hours later, it had mastered all of them. 40 hours. Just think about that if you put that on another problem. So the other question we had was, how do we start today to build ethics into computers to make sure that they don't destroy the human race? And that's a scary thing to think about. And that's one of the reasons you see Bill Gates and Zuckerberg and Elon Musk and Sergey Brin and all those guys trying to buy up a lot of the robotics companies and the AI companies, because they're hoping to be sort of the what do they call that in comics? The something league of whatever, it doesn't matter. They're trying to be this special little group that makes sure that we have a place and that the box, the lid on the Pandora's box stays there. The third thing that was very troubling to all of us was genetic decode and recoding, because Craig Venter got up and said, if we can decode it, we can recode it. While we were there, the first baby with three parents was born, three real parents. They found out that the mother had a genetic defect in her DNA. They got another woman to donate DNA, spliced it together into the mother, the father fertilized the egg, and a baby was born with two real mothers. Also at the same time we were there, they had been doing experiments in China on rats. and injecting them with human DNA to help them learn faster. The first generation of rats were born 11% smarter than the second generation was 11% smarter than the first generation. The third was 11% smarter than the other one. The fourth was 11% smarter than the next one. Go out about 20 times, and the rats take the lab over. I mean, and now if they can do that with rats, they can do that with people, potentially. So then you look into the ethics of what happens. I don't know if any of you have ever seen it, but I've seen some pictures on the internet of dogs that have been genetically modified to have more muscle. And you got one dog that looks like a greyhound, sort of there sitting, hey, what's going on? The other one looks like Arnold Schwarzenegger. I mean, the things like this, there's muscle pouring out, the arms are giant, the legs are huge. It doesn't look anything like the other one. How long will it be with computer algorithms, computer speed, and everything we've got before we can figure out to do the exact same thing to soldiers or athletes? So those were three big questions we left there about robotics and algorithms replacing people, genetic decoding and recoding, and then what was the other one I said? Computer algorithms, computer deep learning. Basically, they call it the technological singularity, when the intelligence of computers surpasses the intelligence of the human race. Could I have a less depressing question? Okay, wait a minute, hold on. You got it because I saw you first. Then it's you, and I'll go fast. Not you, David. All right, yes, sir.
Your experience of working with companies, have you worked with any one company in particular that you look at and say their view of how they deal with the future challenges and how they lead to those is, of a gold standard? Or, at what tip do you into that category of thinking they really had a good mix of qualities?
You're not going to like the answer because it's really only companies that have massive amounts of cash and can invest in this sort of stuff that I would consider the gold standard. Apple, Microsoft, Google, IBM, GE, because they have billions of dollars to throw at it. But here's the other side of the coin. For the rest of us, it's called investing in lifelong learning and making this a priority. The young man that I told you I was mentoring and coaching, his company is a company that specializes in doing physical therapy for people who have been in car accidents. That's all they do. You get in a smash up, they come, they do the therapy, they take care of you, they put on the neck brace, whatever it is. He and I had a great discussion the other day about driverless cars. Google cars now passed 2 million miles with only one real accident. It's had 14 accidents, 8 times it was rear-ended, twice it was sideswiped, one time it actually caused an accident, and that's when the guy had taken it off automatic and was driving it himself. And then I saw the raw footage of it getting hit by the bus or hitting the bus. I think it was a 50-50 deal. But here's the point. That's 95 lifetimes of driving without a single serious accident. Okay? How does that mean if you serve people who get in car accidents and we got cars that'll go 95 lifetimes without an accident? You better figure out a new business model. My wife and I just spent some time with one of the largest truck dealers, over-the-road truck dealers. We have about 3.5, 3.8 million over-the-road long-distance truck drivers in America. His estimation was within 15 years, he will not be selling trucks that have drivers anymore. Or the driver will sit there just in case something goes wrong, like the pilot does in an airplane. Okay. One of the other things I thought was interesting, and it's a statistic a lot of people hadn't heard, but at that conference we heard from someone from FedEx that said that their goal is by 2025, 10 years from today, they fly their entire fleet, I think it was 600 planes, with only 6 pilots. The entire thing is flown by computer joysticks and things with people sitting in a single hub in Houston, Texas, flying all their planes worldwide. That's a little freaky. Love, John. Okay, yes, ma'am.
Okay, John, so...
Wait a minute. Yep. So my answer was, you got to keep up on it. You got to read. I told Andrew that runs his company, you better be learning everything you humanly can about driverless cars. You got to become an expert on this, because if you aren't, you won't see it coming. So it's creating a culture in your company of saying, what field are we in, what arena in, where do we want to play, and then how do we assign things to different people to become subject matter experts on different parts of the business. It's hard, but it's the only way to do it if you don't have $1 billion where you can create Alphabet and have your Google X group that you give them $2 billion to go out and study this stuff. I only got about 200 bucks, so we just got to read it off the internet. Okay, good question.
Okay, so you mentioned that before coming out to New Zealand, you emailed 12 thought leaders that go heard of Gary Vee. Now, Gary Vee is like the master of social media.
Yeah.
He talked about the importance of technology and EQ, but also relationship building. What kind of impact does social media have, do you think?
Okay, what impact does social media have on relationship building? It's a really interesting balance. You can build massive relationships all over the world with people you've never met and probably never will. I don't know if you call that a relationship. From a marketing standpoint and a business standpoint, I can absolutely tell you that the future of advertising, marketing, referrals, all that is word of mouth through social media. The example I love to use is when my book came out, and I'm not plugging it, one of my last books came out, I was number 1131 on the bestsellers list on Amazon. Not exactly impressive. Then Guy Kawasaki tweeted it. And I went from number 1131 to number 11 from one tweet. The reason is he has 1.2 million Twitter followers. When somebody like that recommends your book, things go wild. So from a marketing business standpoint, never in the history of mankind have we had the ability to reach so many people. The other side of the coin is, you know what they all crave? A personal relationship. They want to be in a tribe. They want to be connected. One of the reasons that Gary Vaynerchuk, for those of you that don't know him, is so successful is he has massive social media reach of extremely private and intimate content. And having spent some time with him, and he said he answers every one of the emails that comes to him personally. Every single one. He does a video every day, sometimes two or three videos a day, every day. So his people feel like they know him. And they feel like we're friends, and they feel like he's accessible, which he is. He also is the most profane speaker on the face of the earth. I won't go into it, but let's just say, if you don't like massive amounts of profanity, probably wouldn't enjoy his speeches. yeah, he was out of control in New York City, and in that city, it was a standing ovation. Yeah, cuss more, we love you. So it's that dichotomy of how do you have massive reach and still keep it intimate and personal with a connection. Very, very, very hard to do. People really haven't figured that out. And again, much like education, the platforms are gonna change. It's gonna go really fast. Yahoo just got bought by Nokia.
Verizon,
thank you. Verizon today for?
4.8 billion?
I thought it was 8, wow, thank you. I was just reading it quickly this morning at breakfast. So. Verizon bought Yahoo for $4.8 billion, and they bought them basically for their email list and their user list and some of their talent.
Some real estate.
Yeah. It was a mistake?
Some real estate.
Oh, some real estate. Yeah, but you can buy real estate anywhere when you got gazillions. All right. So good. I think I had one last question over here.
So did biodiversity or global warming come up as issues in the
world? No. That was, it's a big, big impact. But we did not talk about global, like geopolitical stuff, didn't talk about it. Environment, global economies. We focused at this particular one just on technology and the impact it would have on all the businesses. Yeah, cool. One more question and then we're probably done because, no, we're done. Hey, it's been such a pleasure. No, one more and then we'll go.
It was interesting that you used your clients, Microsoft, and Apple, and Amazon, and others as places of the way leadership works?
Not leadership works, of studying innovation and studying coming technologies. Not a good example of leadership. No, never leadership. My comment was, these are the best I've seen at looking around the corner.
So how do you reconcile then treating your employees with the opposite of fairness and supportiveness and collaboration and communication and yet being the most performant organizations in the world?
We'll end on this one because it's fun. Apple's been a client for years. We'll use Steve Jobs as an example. I got to spend some time with Steve Wozniak not too long ago, and he said basically Steve Jobs was an asshole, but he would challenge us constantly. He would say, Steve, I don't think you're smart enough to figure out how to make that thing run cooler. It's impossible. No human could do it. And Wozniak would be like, I'm going to prove him wrong. I don't like that. And he'd go and work and work and we'd come back, I did it. And Steve would go, I knew you could. So leaders like that are basically a cult. They're not leaders. Matter of fact, I would not call Steve Jobs a leader. I would basically call him sort of a cult master or something. But it's the idea that I want to work in the best company, doing the coolest cutting edge stuff, and my boss is out of control mean, but I want to prove him wrong, and I want to be working on stuff that's going to put a dent in the universe. And they overlook. Same thing at Amazon.com right now. Same thing at Microsoft with Gates leaving and Ballmer stepping in, oh my God, the talent flow out of that place was amazing. So a lot of those top companies don't have the best cultures, but they do attract top talent because those people want to work on really cool stuff with really cool colleagues, and they overlook the leadership thing. I'll go back and say the very best companies I've ever worked with are the ones with the best leaders, because they're going to make a difference in the lives of the people that work there in a positive way, not a negative way. And to me, that's a hallmark of a great leader, is leaving a legacy of care and concern and building people up, not tearing them down. And on that note, the floor is yours, sir. My pleasure. Good to see you. Thanks for staying.